All right. Welcome, everybody, and welcome to week 4 of 6 of our Unknown Legends of New Orleans Music. So I want to thank you all for being here. And if you're not here and you're going to watch later on, we want to thank you as well for being a part. As always, this is free for members. We have booked all the way through November now. So I think every single Tuesday, and we'll return to 6 o'clock most nights starting in middle of August. So we'll be going back to that in a couple of weeks. But I hope you're enjoying this. Dance Bands was fantastic. And the Goodson Sisters was, a topic that was very unknown to me. So I hope you will enjoy tonight. Tonight, we're going to be talking about Clarence Williams and Dave Thomas, who is one of our tour guides and a musician as well, is going to be talking about Clarence. And then he's actually going to be back in 2 weeks talking about Spencer Williams. And I know nothing about either one of these guys, so I'm really excited to hear about both of them. So that's the point of all of this. Just to give you an update, Charles will return next week and we'll do the Latin influence of New Orleans music. Then Dave comes back on the 17th and does Spencer Williams. And then we have 2 more in August, which one will start at the 6 p.m. We'll have Category 5, which is Bill Capo's book, WWL reporter, his book, and then Deep Delta Justice, A Black Teen, His Lawyer, and Their Groundbreaking Battle for Civil Rights in the South, by autobiography to an extent by Matthew Van Meter. So I hope you guys are members so that you can attend all of these for free. If not, you can just pay $10, but you can do it for as little as $40 to become a member. So Dave is going to have a little bit of a chat to bring some questions in there. So you can always chat as we go along. I do ask also that you, if you have a question that you think you want to ask, just put it in the chat and we'll get to it at the end. So, I tell people to put them in there so that you don't forget. I write things down and completely forget about them as well. So put them in the chat with the idea that we're going to answer them later on. So with that, I'm going to leave it with Dave. Thank you so much, Dave. And we look forward to today.
Great. Thanks for the introduction, Jason. Always a pleasure to do this. I do like to tell people, Jason described my bio a little bit. I'm not an academic. I always like to put that qualification out there for people. I don't do a lot of primary research and make my living as an academic, but I am a tour guide and a musician, and I love doing music-related music history tours, so I love delving into this stuff. So I need to do some screen sharing here. So can you all see this screen?
Yep.
All right. So, probably those of you that have been following the news know that Clarence Williams died recently. He was the Mob Squad guy. It was actually Clarence Williams III. We're not going to talk about Clarence Williams III. We're actually not going to talk about Mob Squad. We're going to talk about a jazz cat. Clarence Williams, he's the original because he actually is the grandfather of Clarence Williams III, the guy from Mob Squad. Well, there is a literal connection right there. Clarence Williams is responsible for all of these bands and more. So I'm curious, does anybody know of Clarence Williams? And if you are familiar with him at all, why? You know, for what reason? How do you know about him? And if you can just maybe put that stuff in the chat, and I'll count on Jason to read that for me. And it could be nothing. You've never heard of Clarence Williams before.
It might be a new topic to everybody as well.
I'm not surprised it's a new topic, but I do find it just surprising that he is relatively unknown, of course, because that's why we're talking about him.
We have one who said that it's a new topic to her as well. So there you go. Yeah.
He was so ubiquitous in music in the 1920s. So early jazz period and blues period, as a composer and a publisher, Lots of well-known popular performers did his songs, Louis Armstrong in particular, the original Dixieland and Jazz Band, among others. He was a co-composer with other iconic composers, Spencer Williams, that we're going to talk about in 2 weeks, Fats Waller, Andy Razzaf, who did a lot of Fats Waller songs. He was a pianist. He was also a singer. And for lack of a better description, he was what I would call an artistic director. A&R man maybe would be a more contemporary word for him. He did some early classic sides with Louis Armstrong and Sidney Bechet. He was the first one in the studio with Bessie Smith. And he used future jazz legends as his side performers. And that included, again, not exclusively these people, but King Oliver, Coleman Hawkins, two stride piano players by the name of James P. Johnson and Willie the Lion Smith, and Don Redmond, who was a ubiquitous arranger in the swing era. And there are approximately 700 plus recordings that he's affiliated with listed in the discography of American Historical Recordings. So this is amazing, the amount of music he was involved with. There's a great quote out of one of the books that I read. It's called Spreading Rhythm Around Black Popular Songwriters. And they compare him to Perry Bradford, who was a blues entrepreneur on a much smaller scale. And they said, if Perry Bradford was a one-man mom and pop store in the blues business, Clarence Williams was at Kmart. As writer, publisher, plugger, accompanist, talent scout, radio performer, band leader, and supervisor of recording sessions, Williams dominated the blues industry in the 1920s. I want to take one issue here with their characterization. He's definitely just not a blues guy. He's very active in the blues, but he spanned jazz and popular music, very, very broad in terms of his genres. His publishing company owned around 1,500 copyrights. He got recordings for about half of them, and his name, meaning as a writer, a composer, or a lyricist, is on nearly a third of them. He issued over 400 song sheets, and on more than 200 of these published pieces, he's credited as composer, lyricist, or both. He played, sang, and or conducted on more than 700 released recordings. So, he was a singer. Not a very distinguished singer. He didn't actually sing on a lot of recordings. He was a piano player. And nobody really describes him as being really acclaimed for his piano playing or his virtuosity, the technique. As a songwriter, one of the sources I've relied on heavily said that described him as not really having a distinct style in terms of his songs. He tended to take on the style of the co-composers he was writing with. So what was the big deal about him? If he's not really outstanding in any of these things, why was he so successful? And this is also another great quote. He could be outclassed in every creative department except one, the creation of opportunities for himself, his songs, his friends, and his blues. This guy was a hustler. He started out in life as sort of a local boy, born in Blackmans, Louisiana. Probably 1893 and October 8th. There's a lot of discrepancy and even conflict in his birthday. Surprise, surprise. This is a common problem in all these early jazz and blues musicians. There's also an argument to be made that he was born in 1898. I tend to go with 1893 because early activities he had in New Orleans, some of the things he was accomplishing, if he had an 1898 birth date, it just seems like he would have been way, way too young to do any of the stuff he was doing. Parents were Dennis and Sally Williams. His dad, Dennis, was a musician and bass player. Choctaw and Creole heritage, sang at his parents' hotel and in the streets. And he had some early non-musical jobs. Railroad water boy, oppressor. He worked at the Plaquemines Silver Brothers Hotel and tended bar. This is the kid. I mean, he is for sure young at this age. Sang a little bit. We're pretty sure he actually heard Buddy Bolden's band, probably 1905, probably touring and in Plaquemines itself. And he was inspired to leave home at the age of 12 and go out on the road with Billy Kersant's Traveling Minstrel Show and act as a master of ceremonies. There's one story that he was actually working as in his pressing job, and he was pressing clothes and he heard a traveling circus go by and decided that was for him and that. And so he left. I don't know how much credence to put in that story, but it's a good one. So around 1906, he winds up in New Orleans. And he starts making a living at basically doing things similar to what he had been doing in Plaquemine, cleaning business, pressing and mending men's clothing, particularly working with musicians and shoe shining. So he picks up some honky-tonk piano skills. He takes maybe 8 lessons and, according to the early reports, learns 2 songs and goes to work, not only playing some honky-tonk piano, but also as master of ceremonies in and around the story of Valeria. And he is hobnobbing with and even playing with people like Sidney Bechet and King Oliver. Probably played piano in Lulu White's Mahogany Hall, among others. Of course, that was one of the more notorious brothels on Basin Street. He worked at the Poodle Dog Cafe on Rampart, which is now gone. I think it was on the upriver end of North Rampart, but I'm not sure. I don't have a good location for that. Maybe around 1916, he became the manager of Pete Lala's club. That is the picture in the lower right, which was the jam session spot for musicians that was in the heart of Storyville up on the upriver edge. Maybe around 1918, he became the band manager at the 25 Cabaret, which was another nearby venue that featured jazz musicians at the edge of Storyville. The main connection that he made when he was in New Orleans was with A.J. Puron, who was a band leader violinist, and then he hooked up with Clarence Williams and became a publisher and composer, the two of them did. So Duron's background, 1904 is when he begins playing professionally. 1912, he becomes the leader of the Olympia Orchestra. It's already in existence. 1918, he starts leading bands under his name, generally as Duron's New Orleans Orchestra, but he's got a bunch of different names that he works under, the Peerless Orchestra, his Novelty Orchestra. And he plays some of the high-end venues, Pythian Temple, which of course is now the same building as the Pythian Market on Loyola, Spanish Fort, Southern Yacht Club, New Orleans Country Club. So a lot of the resorts of that period. And a little bit later, he does get his band to New York for 2 trips in 1923. He goes up and plays the Cotton Club and then goes back to the Roseland Ballroom. Probably had more of a society band. So if you're familiar with the music of John Robichaux, who had a society orchestra, he was probably in that vein and maybe was even a competitor with John Robichaux. These are pictures of 2 of the different bands he had. The one on the left, it looks kind of like almost a brass band kind of style, but clearly they're not a marching band because you've got an upright bass in the back, and that's a little hard to march with, especially if you want to play it while you're marching with it. So he forms Williams and Perrone Publishing Company. The two of them form that, maybe around 1913. It might be as late as 1915, 1916. Again, there's conflicting sources. It's above a saloon at 1315 Tulane Avenue, which is now Tulane Medical Center. Joined ASCAP maybe in 1914. That's the Society of Composers and Publishers. In 1919, they got a copyright for I Wish I Could Shimmy Like My Sister Kate. And as a composer, it was credited to A.J. Perrone. Although there's a great story, Armstrong actually claims the song came from him, and that Perrone bought the rights from him for $50, but he never paid him. It was a smutty song that Armstrong used to sing in the Storyville venues called Katie's Head or Get Off Katie's Head. And the story is probably actually really more complicated than that. It was probably a song that had been around a long time under various names and adapted by everybody that took it. So, you know, you can argue over, was it Armstrong? Did it predate Armstrong? Did Perrone make enough changes to take credit for it? I don't know if we're ever going to know. And Perrone and Williams did a touring vaudeville act with Perrone on violin and Williams playing piano and singing. And among other things they opened for W.C. Handy, is he's known as the father of the blues. He was the first guy to publish a lot of blues songs. Memphis Blues, St. Louis Blues would be 2 of them. And this picture of Perrone's orchestra up here in the right-hand side of the screen, I'm pretty sure that's Clarence Williams sitting down in front, and Perrone is the guy almost directly behind him with the violin. So Clarence Williams does have some success with songwriting, significant success with songwriting while he's in New Orleans. The notable ones are You Missed a Good Woman When You Picked All Over Me. He sold 5,000 copies in 6 months, and he was just flogging this hard repick. He would go door to door and try to sell the lead sheets. If somebody had a piano, we'd go in their house and play the song for them. He'd set up in department stores and play and try to sell the lead sheets. And so he kind of learned about marketing his songs. I Can't Beat What You're Doing Me, Brown Skin, Who You For, was primarily recorded by the Victor Military Band in 1916. And he got a $1,600 check in 1916. He said somebody slipped it under the door, I think where he was at a studio. And there may be a lost recording that he made with his first wife. It was a marriage that didn't last very long. Didn't make it to the end of his time in New Orleans. 1917, he and Perrone are using I Wish I Could Shimmy Like My Sister Kate by then, even though it's not copyrighted till 1919. And he wrote I Don't Want It, You Can Have It, which was published by Williams and Perrone in 1917, but only popularized later by Eddie Cantor. All right, so what is the significance of the years in New Orleans, because he's going to leave in 1918 and he's not really going to come back to work at all. Well, there's three things primarily that he built his career on that happened in New Orleans. One of them was he had a commercial success as a music publisher and specifically figured out how to promote his songs. And he also had commercial success as a composer. So he not only knows he can do this, he knows he can make a living at it. And then he develops relationships with future musical legends that are going to become very instrumental later on, most importantly with Sidney Bechet, but also Louis Armstrong, King Oliver, and some others. So 1918, he heads up to Chicago, opens several music stores up there, still publishing under Williams and Perrone, and he gets into multiple performing roles, both musical and theatrical. One of the most important is he's working at the Royal Gardens in Chicago, I think as an MC from the description. And that's where he met a singer and a dancer by the name of Eva Taylor, who was born Irene Gibbons. And that's significant because when they hook up again in New York, they're going to get married. And it was also his inspiration for Royal Garden Blues, a song he wrote with Spencer Williams. And it was an early original Dixie 9 jazz band recording from 1921. So this is one of their first batch of recordings from the early period when they were really establishing reputation. And he left as a result of the 1920 race riots. Although I think he actually was back and forth between New York and Chicago in 1920 and 1921. Significant event connection he makes in Chicago was hooking up with Spencer Williams, and he becomes a songwriting partner, essentially as a replacement for A.J. Perrone in terms of the business relationship. And they hit right away. The first three songs they have, 1919, Royal Garden Blues, which is a real big deal. It's not just the original Dixieland Jazz Band. There are so many bands that record this. Louis Armstrong, Tommy Dorsey, Big Spiderbeck, Bob Crosby, Zutty Singleton. The list goes on and on and on. They also had another song called I Ain't Gonna Give You None of This Jelly Roll, frequently recorded as I Ain't Gonna Give Nobody None of This Jelly Roll. And Sidney Bechet is one of the people that recorded that. Mamie Smith's Jazz Hounds. And Jimmy Davis recorded that. So Jimmy Davis, do we know Jimmy Davis? Yes, that's the Jimmy Davis we're talking about. This is the governor of Louisiana who is credited with being the composer of You Are My Sunshine, although he probably actually bought the song from somebody else. He actually recorded a song called I Ain't Gonna Give Nobody None of This Jelly. And Yama Yama Blues got some traction. Later, it was recorded by one of Clarence Williams' bands. So Spencer Williams sounds like a big enough deal that he should have a session of his own. And so that's what we're going to do in 2 weeks. This is the shameless plug for Spencer Williams. And the way I would describe him is you probably do not know his name, because in my experience doing tours, nobody's ever heard of Spencer Williams. But you absolutely, absolutely know not just one of his songs, but a bunch of his songs. And that's what we're gonna plow through, including his relationship with Clarence Williams in 2 weeks. So I hope you'll join us for that. Also in the Chicago period, Clarence published what was probably his most valuable copyright. It was a song called Sugar Blues. A woman by the name of Lucy Fletcher came to him with lyrics and needed some music written to it. So Clarence wrote some music to it. They published it, and it made him a lot of money. The song that person that it's most closely identified with is this guy by the name of Clyde McCoy, who played kind of a wah-wah cornet or wah-wah trumpet sound. The Clyde McCoy Orchestra made four different recordings of it, starting in 1931, I think, is the earliest one. And across the four recordings, it sold 14 million copies. So it was providing a lot of revenue to Clarence. And then a lot of other people recorded it. You can see some of the names here. Clarence did several versions himself under different names. One of them, the most interesting I find is down here in the blue highlight, Bob Wills and his Texas Playboys. That's a Western swing band, if you're familiar with Western swing. And it kind of evolved into a genre on its own. But when Western swing started, it was just swing music. It was in the 1930s and they were just playing swing music, but they used the instruments that they had in the Southwest, specifically in Texas and Oklahoma. So it's not just horns and reeds, they're also using a lot of string instruments, violins, fiddles specifically. And Bob Wills has a recording of that. So Clarence moves to New York, I think first in the 1920s, he goes to Chicago, back to Chicago to wrap up some stuff, and then essentially relocates permanently in 1921. And when he gets there, he initially concentrates on performing and song promoting. Oh, wait, you know what? Sorry. You got to hear Sugar Blues. Got a better volume?
Yeah, it's a little in and out, but you can hear it.
So that's just a single chorus of Sugar Blues. On a lot of these talks I've done, I tend to do a lot of sampling. In this one, there's actually several songs we're going to play all the way through because they're fairly significant. So back to New York. 1921, he moves Williams and Perrone to New York, their publishing company, this is specifically. And in 1922, he buys out A.J. Perrone and converts the name to the Clarence Williams Music Publishing Company. And so that's really what most of his publishing is going to be known for. He makes his first recording session in October of 1921 and makes it as a vocalist. He's not playing piano. He has backup musicians for that. And he's a co-composer on four out of five of the songs. So you understand his business model here. He kind of thinks of the recordings as a way to plug his songs and get his songs out there. And then in 1922, again in October, he has his first session as what I would describe as an artistic director. Basically, he's leading the session. And it's accompanying a singer by the name of Sarah Martin on piano. And he is going to have a long, long relationship with her. And the reason he's playing piano is he had signed up Fats Waller to do it, and he didn't show up for the session. And then in 1923, there is the first label mention of a band called Clarence Williams Blue Five, which is fairly significant because that is going to be the primary name that he uses to record his jazz sides. So overall, between 1923 and 1929, he releases 50 to 100 recordings each year. 1923, he sells his Chicago music stores. In the fall of 1923, he starts to employ Sidney Bechet as a music manager for the publishing company. And he's got Sidney Bechet also playing on sides for him. There's a 1926 reorganization of the publishing company. And two of the interesting personnel that are identified is Spencer Williams. He has him not only as a songwriter, but what he calls a band and orchestra manager. And Clarence Todd, who's a singer that he used a lot in his trio, he has him also as a professional manager. So he's got these intertwined relationships with his business partners. They might be serving multiple functions. The business starts to decline in the 1929s. His peak is really through the decade in the 1920s, and it's really starting to feel the effect of the Depression. He's got a bunch of label affiliations through this period. For 5 years, 1923 to 1928, he's a recording director for OK Records. It's an exclusive agreement, although he records for a whole bunch of other different labels, mostly under different names. Working with Columbia in the mid-1920s, he has a relationship with QRS, Quality Recording Services. They were primarily a piano roll thing, but they flirted with musical recordings through different periods. And from 1928 to 1929, he had a long period working behind vocalists. And then he's a blues advisor to just countless labels. I listed some at the bottom, but it's not even comprehensive. And then the significant thing for both his personal and his professional life is he hooks up with Eva Taylor. She's been performing since she was about 3 years old, and she's got an established radio career when Clarence Williams shows up in New York. So he kind of piggybacks on that. He starts working as her piano player on all these radio shows. And the radio stuff goes on very strongly through the decade. They're on the air frequently as a trio with Clarence Williams playing piano and Eva Taylor and Clarence Todd singing. She's on NBC's Cavalcade in 1929, a lot of years on WOR. She's with Paul Whiteman's radio show in 1932, and that was a white band. And she essentially got her nickname, the Dixie Nightingale, from a recording she made in 1922 with Black Swan Records. Her personal life is interesting. Three children and the names in particular, I love this. So one of them is Clarence Jr. So that would become the dad for Clarence Williams III. And he was a little bit of a composer early on his career and later went to work for the city and state of New York. Irene, so that's again named after Eva, her real name. Her nickname was Joy. She got into acting and died in the mid 1970s. And the second son is named Spencer. So he's even named his son. Clarence and Eva have even named their son after Spencer Williams, the songwriter and the partner. They have a few significant recordings early on. Possibly the first recording of him accompanying Eva Taylor is in 1922. And the first song that actually has a recording labeled as Clarence Williams' Blue Five is one with Eva Taylor in 1923. And this is the instrumentation that he's basically going to stick with for most of the Blue Five recordings: piano, cornet, trombone, reed player, and a banjo. So 1923 is when he really starts with what I would call his legacy recordings. There's a blues craze that explodes starting in 1920. So I'm of an age when I think of blues players, it's old black guys from rural locations, the Delta or the Piedmont or East Texas. And that's because in the 1960s, there was a big blues revival, and it was old black guys who had been young black guys in the 1930s when they were creating all this music. And a lot of people forget that they were predated by a whole decade with a blues craze that exploded at the beginning of the 1920s, and it was all women, specifically female singers. It got kicked off by Mamie Smith. She had a hit with a song called Crazy Blues from 1920, and it sold 75,000 copies in the first month and 1 million copies in the first year. So this is crazy. This market just comes out of nowhere and everybody jumps on it. Ma Rainey was kind of a crossover person between vaudeville and blues. She worked with Paramount Records. Probably her most well-known song historically is called Black Bottom Blues. And she was a mentor to Bessie Smith. Bessie Smith toured with her and worked on her. And that's significant because starting in 1923, Bessie Smith is going to launch her career to become the Empress of the Blues. And she became the highest paid black entertainer of her day, male or female. She did 160 recordings for Columbia Records. And Clarence Williams is the guy that's credited with finding her and bringing her into the studio. There's a lot of people that like to claim credit for participating in the process. His manager at Columbia Records was a guy by the name of Frank Walkard, who really has nice things to say about Clarence. You can read this. The last sentence is he could somehow manage to get the best out of performers, and to this day hasn't received the credit he really deserves. So Frank claimed some credit for this. He basically said that nobody knew about Bessie Smith. So he sent Clarence Williams to find her down south and brought her into the studio. So 1923, February 16th, Clarence Williams goes into the studio with Bessie Smith to record two songs, Gulf Coast Blues, which is one of his compositions, and Downhearted Blues. And these songs take off and establish her who is going to become the Empress of the Blues. And the very first thing you hear on Gulf Coast Blues, so the very first notes on the first iconic record. So I wanted to get you through enough of that song so you could actually hear Clarence Williams' little piano break there. So you could get a feel for the style of his piano playing. He's involved in a lot of other stuff with her. Oh, Daddy, Tain't Nobody's Business. He actually does Cakewalk and Babies from Home in 1925, which is the first of her electric recordings. So there's all this early stuff. It's all acoustic. It's mechanical. She sings into a big horn, and it's all mechanical to cut the disc. Of all of the 160 recordings she does for Columbia, over 50 of them somehow have an involvement with Clarence Williams, either a piano playing composer or something else. And four dozen of those he co-composed or composed himself. So it was a big deal. Their relationship was somewhat turbulent. There were other blues singers that Clarence was involved with. Clarence Smith was another one of her 122 recordings. Clarence was actually had 10 compositions, and he actually recorded with her on two of them. And interestingly enough, the blues craze resurfaced fairly recently. There was a biography of Bessie Smith in 2015 that Queen Latifah put together, and she played Bessie Smith. And then just last year, we had Ma Rainey's Black Bottom with Viola Davis. He did a lot of other accompanying vocalists. I really don't want to go through it in detail other than to say this is the way he made a lot of his money and did a lot of his recordings, was to either play piano or put bands up behind singers. 1923, 1924, 1925 are also, it's also the period when I would say he did his second set of what I would call legend recordings or legendary recordings. Legacy recordings maybe might be a nice word for him. Whereas, you know, if this is what he left behind, he would be well remembered. He did the first recorded sessions that had both Louis Armstrong and Sidney Bechet playing together. And this is a big deal because these guys were recognized as kind of the hot solo improvisers for jazz out of New Orleans. So to get the two of them together was actually pretty incredible. He had been using Bechet as a sideman through most of 1923. And then in 1924, he comes up with seven sessions, total of 13 songs with just Armstrong. And he had five sessions, a total of 10 songs with both Armstrong and Bechet. And both of these guys are playing with two ensembles that are known as Clarence Williams Blue Five or the Red Onion Jazz Babies. And they're essentially the same ensemble in terms of instrumentation. It's what we talked about before, piano, cornet, a reed, a trombone, and a banjo, and then a vocalist on top of that. And the difference is in the Red Onion Jazz Babies, the piano player was Lil Hardin. It was not Clarence Williams. So Lil Hardin, of course, shared the band with King Oliver's band with Armstrong and then later married him. And vocalists were Alberta Hunter and Clarence Todd. And in the Blue Five, Clarence himself played piano and his wife, Eva, sang. So we're going to explore these recordings in some of them in a fair amount of detail because they are worth it. They are that important and they are that interesting that it's worth doing it. Of the earlier Sidney Bechet ones from 1923, probably the most interesting is Wildcat Blues. It was the first song published by Fats Waller. And it became an established kind of signature song for Sidney Bechet that he played throughout his career. This is the first recording that he had, so listen to it. Thank you. That's Sidney Bechet on the soprano saxophone. Maybe to give you a little bit of background on why these guys are significant. So Louis Armstrong, probably everybody knows about him, widely recognized as the most influential person in the history of jazz. Sidney Bechet was at least as much of a virtuoso musician as Armstrong was. He turned out to be much less influential because he spent a lot of time in Europe, and there's some other reasons. He had a salty personality and a lot of other musicians didn't get along with him. He dabbled in a bunch of different instruments, landed on the clarinet, and discovered the soprano saxophone basically in the late 19-teens when he was on tour in Europe. And he was one of the people that was instrumental in bringing the saxophone into the jazz idiom. The early bands, jazz bands, none of them used any saxophones, alto, tenor, soprano. And that's so interesting because now we think of the tenor saxophone in particular as kind of intrinsic to what we think of as jazz now. And he was a part of that process. So then the first session where Armstrong and Bechet are playing together is one song recorded called Texas Motor Blues. It's instrumental, and you can hear them going back and forth. So after they do the opening phrases, each of the frontline instruments takes a lead, and you'll hear the trombone player doing the first one with responses from Armstrong and Bechet. Then I think Armstrong is second with responses by Bechet and the trombone, and then Bechet's last, I believe, with Armstrong and the trombone player. I might have those last two reversed. And so you get to see kind of how they're really taking on each other in their fills and their breaks and their solos.
Thank you.
I don't know if you could hear it in so when Armstrong was taking his solo or his lead part, he has breaks in there. So that's where the rest of the band stops playing and he plays through a measure or two. And there's one where he plays out of time. He speeds up, then he comes back in exactly where the meter is and the rest of the band joins him. And then Bechet, when he follows on his lead part, he does a similar thing, or I think not quite as elegantly as Armstrong does it. There's more recording sessions with Armstrong as both part of the Blue Five and the Red Onion Jazz Babies, including a vocal version of Texas Moaner Blues. Late December, there's a session with the two of them. And one of the songs that gets recorded is called Mandy, Make Up Your Mind. And it's got Bechet playing sousaphone. I gave you a picture over here, a drawing and a picture of somebody playing it. I think it's a double reed instrument. So I think the closest analog would be a bassoon. And that's what it sounds like to me on the recording. Also, it sounds as if there's a bassoon on there. I think on this recording, he is playing both soprano saxophone and the sousaphone, because you can hear them at different parts in there, and there's no other soprano saxophone player listed. So I think he must be putting up and picking down the different instruments. He has the sousaphone early on, then he plays the soprano saxophone later in the piece, and he takes a solo on the sousaphone. And this is the only known sousaphone jazz solo on record. Sidney Bechet with his sousaphone solo. Now the last two songs I want to play in their entirety for you. a really interesting comparison. Late 1924, with the Red Onion Jazz Babies, Clarence has a session with both Armstrong and Bechet, and they do a version of Cakewalkin' Babies. And then early in 1925, he has another session with the Blue Five and does another version of Cakewalkin' Babies. He's re-recording songs all the time. He's basically all about figuring out, how can I get these things recorded so I'll get them out there? And what's really interesting is, to me, if you listen to the first one from 1924, there's a big competition between Armstrong and Bechet, and Armstrong gets smoked. The cornet tends to have the melodic line, and the soprano saxophone that Bechet played is more of a response. So Armstrong is confined to playing these phrases. And Bechet would normally have a phrase that was either a response to the cornet or maybe another variation of the melody. And he just plays these continuous phrases. He doesn't take a breath, and he just plays all over Armstrong. Well, I think I'm totally making this up, but when I listen to these songs, it's like Armstrong remembered that. And when they did the recording in 1925, he came loaded for revenge. And he's playing a lot more aggressively and even a little recklessly on the second recording. So we're going to compare those. First one, Red Onion Jazz Babies, late 1925. Alberta Hunter and Clarence Todd, by the way. And now this version with Eva Taylor singing, Clarence Williams playing piano, and Armstrong, I think, is out for revenge. And those actually were the last sessions with Armstrong and Bechet until 1940, when Armstrong, Bechet, and Clarence Williams were brought together again to record a little bit of a kind of a jazz, New Orleans jazz compilation album. Armstrong does have some more sessions in later in 1925, but then that's the end of it for him, mostly because he goes back to Chicago. He leaves the Fletcher Henderson Orchestra. So we're going to run through some other stuff quick and just get you to the wrap up. Lots of sidemen that played with Clarence Williams of significant note. One of the most interesting is a guy by the name of Coleman Hawkins, who was an early tenor saxophone soloist. He's basically the guy that created the tenor saxophone as a solo instrument in jazz. And he's interesting because, among other things, he is credited with having the first bebop recording session in 1944. Clarence Williams recorded under jazz names. The most common one was Clarence Williams Blue Five. But in 1926, he actually started working with washboard bands. And he used washboard as percussion. That was the dominant percussion in his recordings. He really did not use a drummer very, very much. Overwhelmingly, he probably used a washboard 10 to 20 times as much as he used a drummer. He was even involved in a musical. When I say involved, it was his. He basically created it, wrote the songs, was the music director and piano player, and it was pretty much a failure. It ran for 1 week in Atlantic City, came into New York City, and lasted less than a month, and the critics weren't very kind to him. 1930s and beyond, the recordings decrease. He's really concentrating. Well, part of the reason for that is the Depression kicks in. Movies are dominating popular culture, and he's concentrating on radio performances, and then later in the decade, more emphasis on publishing. 1936, he actually does no recordings at all. His final recording session is in 1941. In 1943, he sells his catalog to Decca for $50,000, which doesn't sound like very much money. But the key, I think, here is that he retained a partial interest. He retained a third interest in the publishing and a half interest in the composition. So he's still essentially making money off that, even though he sold it. End of his life, he struck by a taxi in 1953, caused some blindness, but he had at least a partial recovery from that, suffered a bunch of strokes. And he was blind for the last 7 years of his life as a result of diabetes and died in 1964. So we'd like to let his wife have the last word. She said he had a smile for everyone, but took life very seriously. Great respect for the man upstairs. Never used profanity and did not allow it to be used in the office. As a musician, he was not a great soloist. And I love that even his wife is acknowledging this. But for a singer, he played all around the voice with harmony that made the singer want to sing. Shrewd businessman, not a college graduate, no loopholes in his contracts. Office always open to all and never too busy to listen to newcomers. He had many friends in the music world. So I think it's fitting that his wife is the one that has the last word on who he was. If you're interested in some other sources, the kind of the Bible is this book by Tom Lord called Clarence Williams by Storyville Publications, 1976. Storyville is actually a British music magazine from the 1960s through 2003, and they loved Clarence Williams. They actually published a complete discography of him, probably over a year of issues. They had several interviews published with Eva Taylor. Tom Lord was one of the contributors. I don't know if he was the editor or the publisher at the time, but he got the Storyville staff together and they created this book. I got my copy actually shipped from Australia because it's a relatively obscure book. And the way I would describe it is sort of a very heavily annotated discography. The structure is laying out the recordings, but he fills in a lot with interviews and stuff from the Chicago Defender. So this is really the source for a lot of stuff. The discography of American Historical Recordings is great because they list all the songs that are associated with Clarence Williams' label when they were recorded. There are a couple of interesting articles. One is in the Louisiana History Association, Historical Association Journal from 1999. called Those Everlasting Blues, The Best of Clarence Williams. It's kind of, the author says that she basically tries to build on the Tom Lord book. And there's another one, good one, from the Jazz Archivist, which is what the journal published by Tulane, another look at Clarence Williams' early career, which really fleshes out a lot of detail about his time in New Orleans. And then, as you saw, I quoted an article from Spreading Rhythm Around by Jason and Jones. So that's the story. I'd be happy to deal with any questions that you might have.
Yeah, if we have any questions, if you'd like to put them in the chat, I'd be happy to ask Dave. I will kick it off, Dave. And they're kind of intertwined a little bit, but although they're very, very well spread out here. Is there any kind of anywhere that kind of recognizes his impact on New Orleans jazz in, I guess, Plaquemines or Orleans or anywhere like that or anywhere else? And then second to that would be, and maybe the reason is this, is what do you think what would have happened to jazz musicians like this who were big but didn't have the name, but then the Depression doesn't happen? I mean, do you think that a lot of more people like this would become more famous because of that?
I don't know. So let's do the first one first. I don't know of any like public recognition that he's got, like statue or memorial or anything. Now, I haven't really explored Plaquemines to check it out, but I think outside of jazz aficionados, people just don't know about him, and they don't, you know, that's another one of these baffling things of these unknown legends, that he was so ubiquitous and so influential. And still this stuff, it's the stuff we talked about, gets played today. You can walk down to Bourbon Street, you can walk down to Frenchman Street, you can hear them playing Clarence Williams songs, and nobody knows about him. So the second one was, what would have happened? I think a lot of these careers have an arc to them.
Okay.
And a part of what happened was he was piggybacking on so much, so many blues performers in that period. And this blues craze sort of played itself out. You get into the 30s and nobody's paying much attention to it, or nobody has much interest in it anymore. And it could have partially been driven by the Depression, but I think it was perceived as dated music. It was a similar thing as to what happened to traditional jazz. You know, you get into swing and the musicians and a lot of the audience, they have disparaging things to say about traditional jazz musicians because they think it's old fogey music. And the entertainment medium broadened too. We alluded to it, but movies start to come in and compete for the entertainment dollar. So I suspect that the arc of these careers would have been similar, but maybe not as dramatic a fall off if you hadn't had the Depression.
And I think about when you bring up movies, your lecture you did, I can't remember, the one on Earl Palmer.
Right.
And how he totally transformed his career because he found a new medium that he could work in. And basically his career kept going on and was still strong all throughout. Right. That he changes his medium, and that's the difference why his career was maybe a little bit different. I did look up what $50,000 in 1943 was worth. Do you know what that, hypothetically, what they say it's worth?
No, what was it?
$800,000.
Okay, so he made a good bargain, a good sale on his catalog. Yeah. That's good. That's good to know. Yeah, that's one of the things I didn't bother to do, is to figure out, well, how much money really is this? Yeah, I love your Earl Palmer example, because that's exactly what happened. Earl Palmer, you heard him on the radio all the time. You didn't know it was Earl Palmer. Yeah. And then you stopped hearing him on the radio. And it wasn't because his career collapsed. It's because he found out, oh, I can make more money and I can play more interesting stuff if I'm working for the movies. So if you went to the movies, you'd go hear Earl Palmer, but you didn't know that.
That's right. It's
a really good analogy.
All right. Well, if we don't have any other questions, next week we'll be doing the Latin influences of New Orleans music. Dave, off the top of your head, who do you think Charles is going to be talking about?
My guess is he's probably going to tie some of it back to the Cuban stuff.
Yeah.
He's going to talk about the Mexican band, probably, that was here for the World's Fair. And he absolutely is going to talk about Jelly Roll Morton.
Yeah, that's what I figured too.
Yeah.
So I look forward to seeing everybody next week at 4 o'clock. And thank you again so much for being here. And thank you for being a member or purchasing a ticket. And Dave, thank you so much. I appreciate it. We'll see you in 2 weeks.
You're welcome. All right. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Yes. Maybe we need to get a statue of him, Armstrong Burt. I agree.